Welcome, listeners, to Just Neapolitan. Today I'm joined by Eddie and Floyd, and I'm your resident, fuck it, I'll do it on the day, Bryan.
Hello.
How you boys doing?
I'm alright.
I am filled with happiness and sadness.
I can hear one of those in your voice.
Wes.
How are you?
What?
What was that?
Fantastic start.
Yeah. Perfect, actually. I was going to ask, why happiness and sadness?
Well, I reached a milestone right before we decided to broadcast. I got my new city I'm building up to 80,000 people.
Oh, that's nice.
It really was. It took a lot of work to fit that many people in the space I was working with. But unfortunately, the sadness comes from the fact that I was making a little canal for my ferry way that I made to transport people all around. And I went a little too crazy on the terraforming, and I didn't notice. And the city's grown so big that I can't see it in one picture anymore. So I got to look around to find problems. And I don't know what I did to the geography of the world, but I fucked up something and my entire city flooded.
Damn.
Yeah. I pushed up something.
Nice.
You broke the levees.
Yeah, so instead of having 80,000, I looked up and I had about 12,000 people left in that city.
Wow.
And because I flooded it so harshly, I destroyed all the infrastructure, including the roads. So even rebuilding it would just be a painstaking process for no reason. So,
you know what you do now?
What's that?
You turn it into Venice. It's all canals, baby.
I would.
You just got to go all in on it now.
Yeah, but now I have so many structures and so many things in place that I'm bleeding money because there's nobody there to use any of the services or... There's nothing anywhere. I'm just bleeding. It hurts.
Yeah, so Venice.
But yeah, it was a befitting end to City Skylines 1 as I await City Skylines 2 on the 6th of September.
So close, yet so far.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. But that's the reason behind my happy sad.
So, let's ask the question that I know the answer to, but I've been waiting for... What games have you guys been playing?
Floyd, would you like to start?
I've been playing Pokemon Raids. So, which is funny because I have been doing my raids, but I've also majorly just been playing Baldur's Gate 3.
Yes. Yeah. Now, I'm going to ask this of both of you. Like, please, I want to hear the experience. Please, no plot spoilers.
Okay.
Oh.
That's easy enough.
That's all I asked.
That's
cool. I got like 42 hours in the game, and I'm still in Act 1, so I can't really spoil much for you.
Jesus.
I have 2 hours less than Floyd. And actually, Floyd, if I'm correct, you're at 59, I'm at 58.
Really?
I'm at 57.
Okay.
Yeah. And I have just now crested into Act 2.
It's like, I'm not even level 5 yet.
I just hit 5.
Computer.
Actually, if we're being fair, I hit 5 right into Act 2.
Got it. That makes sense.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm getting sidetracked by a bunch of stuff because I'm just trying to like open up the map, the opening map area. So I was like, let me just wander around and see what I get into. Everything. That's the answer to that one.
Well, no spoiler. I opened up Act 2 by shooting a thunderous arrow into a befallen beast's face and watching it plummet into the depths of hell. The end.
Hilarious.
It was the greatest time I've ever had being scared of something.
Oh, speaking of, I got into a fight with a giant level 5 spider that I shouldn't have won that fight against. And all because I literally just smacked it off a cliff and it died.
That's the best way. but we don't.
That's so D&D.
Yeah.
To give my ultimate opinion, normally... Like,
Gust of Wind is the shittiest spell until you're out of cliff.
Absolutely.
And then it's like, boom, those four people are dead. Cool. I mean, we can't loot them, but fuck
right.
it.
No spoiler, because D&D, within D&D's realm, this isn't a spoiler. Mage Hand cures all things that you can't normally reach.
I mean, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I've just learned several lessons. To give my honest opinion about Baldur's Gate, because normally I do not care how anybody feels or sometimes how I feel about the game I'm playing. This is what I've always wanted out of D&D without all the paper and pencils, but I wanted the DM to care. And this takes out the fact of how you're feeling today. It doesn't give a fuck about what you need to think of. The story's there. The moments are there. This is perfect. There are actual roles. Things matter. Critical failures matter. I love it. I love it so much.
Now, I gotta ask, are you guys save scumming, or are you actually just letting it happen?
No, for the most part, I let it happen. Unless, you know, we get wiped, and then I'm like, all right, time to go back.
Yeah, but yeah, so, getting wiped isn't save scumming.
Yeah.
Scumming is like before every discussion with any character, like, oh, I'm going to save and then we're going to like go through. And if I accidentally get a critical failure.
No.
Because I'm like, that's half of the fun is having to deal with like, oh, well, we fucked up. And
now I will admit if that's save scumming, I've done some things out of boredom. Where I'm like, I'm tired. I just put in some solid hours. Let me get a good save right here. I wonder what happens if I kill this guy. What? How will everybody react? Like, what? How strong is he? Can I pickpocket this person? Just something I wouldn't do in my first playthrough. And I'll just go ahead and do it and catch the reaction real quick. And I just run away and just jump off a cliff or something. You know, all that four out the game. But there are moments where I'll see something. I'm like, I know I can't win this fight. And I know I'm going to go a different direction, but let's see if I even got a chance. And usually I find out in two turns that I never had a chance to begin with. So it's never like I go too far with anything. Sometimes I just push the trigger on a situation like, let me see if I can just bullshit this way through. And I usually get what I deserve. And because you asked that question, you got me to the greatest point of why I like this game. It forces me. It literally forces me to have some strategy. Even if my strategy is punch the guy and back up, you better think about it first. Think about how you're going to
back. Plenty of fights have been won that way.
Yes, but see, this was the first time that I had to truly understand what the disengage was for. This is the first time where I had to make the steps count, where positioning mattered.
Oh, yeah.
But this is also where I've learned high cheese, the cheese of gods. Yeah, no spoilers, but I have a, you know, you get some crazy magical weapons down the line. I'm pretty sure there's some great ones waiting on me. I happen to cross a spear that, when thrown, shows back up in your inventory. I've been doing dirty things with this spear. I like to coat it in oil and throw it into fire pits when nobody's looking. Sometimes I'll climb on top of buildings and see how far I can throw it. And because it's D&D, high ground and low ground mean so much. Oh, I love the things I can get away with. It's just a beautiful thing.
That reminds me of the time where I like cheesed this bridge fight. Like you know which one I'm talking about, Eddie. Like So I went over there. I started the fight. And then hop back over the bridge and put two people right in front so they couldn't hop over. And I just started spamming them with crossbows and fucking magic until they died. I wasn't finna get jumped. I was like, nah, y'all finna sit here and get funneled.
Ironically enough, that same bridge you're talking about, I got Mage Hand pushed off that bridge.
Damn.
Yep, and because I know you haven't been to this city. That's how I found out you can do certain things with Mage Hand. I didn't think
because it
I
happened you to you.
Could, yep, because that's how I learned in this game. Somebody does something, I go, I didn't know you could do that.
Oh, fuck you. Oh, Okay.
Exactly. Throwing that spear, I told you know what that conversation led up to. Throwing that spear let me realize exactly what, who, and where is throwable, and it's been a good time ever since. And even though I am officially playing as July the Monk now,
He lives.
oh my God, I'm having so much fun being the Avatar who never uses his powers. He just slaps people. I spend all my time positioning people next to ledges, not to cheese them with fall damage, but because I have so many things. I've built my monk in the way of the push, as I like to call it. Everything, even my punches push people back. I want you to fall. I want to see it.
Yeah, I had this fucking annoying ass archer run up to a roof. So I ran up there, pushed him off the roof, and then magic missiled him until he died. Just fuck you.
See, I'm now in the world of shadow step pushing people. Yeah. It's getting pretty sickly where I'm at. And at level 5, I can uniquely say fuck spell slots. That's what I got to say. Fuck spell slots, and I wish Baldur's Gate wouldn't be so accurate about how they feel about things, because I would love to spam the spells of this game, but they do not allow you to do it if you want to. I've wasted my entire arsenal on one fight, not understanding a spell slot system. And just Witherspoon. But I'm sorry, I could talk about this game all day. I love that game. I love it so much.
Yes, I cannot wait to be a bard.
Bryan, oh my fucking God. Every time I see the bard, I can't
I
play
already
it.
decided. I'm like, that's I'm starting with the bard.
I need you to be a gnome, though, Bryan. Take my word for it. I need you to be the gnome.
Well,
Please.
but if I make a gnomish bard, then I'd basically be recreating my character from our last D&D
Yes,
campaign.
do it, do it, do it. You can do
So
all
I
the
have to
things.
be
You can do all the
chaotic evil.
things.
No, I
I
just.
don't know if I want to do an evil playthrough my first time.
Every time I talk to an animal, I goes, I shouldn't be doing this. I shouldn't. My care. I shouldn't have put this on this kid. I don't care about speaking to animals, but I know a guy who would. I know a guy who. I talk to every animal I see just because I know Brian would. I want to know what happened to you. I also got a bad habit of reviving random dead people on the road and asking them questions if they want to talk. What happened to you? It's just.
I mean, the game's there to be enjoyed.
Yeah, but there's a problem that exists in this game, though, and it's the one downside, which I'm sure in future patches or maybe never. If but so let's say we get the game and me, you, Floyd, we decide to get a playthrough going. That's fine, that's dandy. Those characters will always exist right there. They will never leave. We cannot have one simple game where I have a game, you have a game, we have a game, we come together and we make that. No. We have to have a simple existence outside of all three of our own natural playthroughs
We have
where
to have
only
like,
we play.
yeah, we have to have like our own group game, because the second you invite somebody into your game, the character is locked into your party and you can't get rid of them.
Exactly. Which is why I hate it, because I would
Which, I
love
mean, makes sense though.
Yeah,
I mean,
it
with a game
does.
like
It
that, you
does, but it
shouldn't,
sucks.
Like they give you a camp, and other NPCs can go to the camp. So, in my brain, you can just send like your friend's character to the camp when they're not in the game, instead of them being locked
No.
into your party.
But they said no.
That's true. But it would be cool
No, I mean,
if all three of us had like a game that we and I can I Eddie, you might as well delete that one save. I want to bring Torin back in that one.
first off, Savon LeBlanc is a name I'm going to use again. So I'm definitely never there. But yeah, I mean, that's fine, because of course we're going to have a playthrough together. But it sucks because, like I said, we all are such different creatures of day and night. It's hard for us to get together. We have to play that game for like 20 hours straight to understand each other and how we want to play. Because the next time I play, I want to go full in. Like, if we're going to be character locked, might as well. We're technically not character locked. I'm not spoiling anything for Brian, but if we're going to do it, I'd rather just be who I'm going to be and play the role. And I love that the game allows you to do that.
Yeah, that's gonna be fun.
We really need a solid fourth.
I really needed a computer.
Truth.
There's truth in these statements.
Mm-hmm. I keep thinking about getting it, so you know that might be it.
It would be the greatest playthrough that
Aang ever lived. Aang's gonna play D&D?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, she will fucking quit after like 2 hours with us.
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe not.
There's no way she will put up with our shit.
Especially with the shit you can get away with. Oh, God. I'd steal Maggie. I'd steal everything out of her back pocket.
Apparently, I don't know what happened, because in my game I'm playing as a paladin, and I don't know where I fucked up at, but one day I went back to the camp, and it was this really intimidating looking, like, knight guy, right? So I was like, okay, I go talk to him, because I'm like, why the fuck are you in my camp, bro? And he is like, ah, I come for all the oath breakers. So I was like, when the fuck did I break my oath?
Oh, no.
Oh, damn.
Yeah.
No, no, no.
You gotta. Yeah, if you're a paladin, you gotta. You actually gotta, you know, make sure.
That's funny. You got Oathbreaker, and I get Vampire Hunters. That's nice. Imagine being a vampire in the middle of the day, walking up to a vampire hunter who tells you he's looking for a vampire. And the game allows you to go,
I'm a vampire.
Is he looking for me? No, no. Is he looking for me to the other members of the party? It's just a great time. I just the ignorance that game lets you portray is just all time great.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, you know,
and
like,
I can push Floyd off a cliff
if you're stupid. If you're stupid in a D&D campaign,
yeah.
I mean,
it's
yeah.
like, okay, here's your consequence. I don't know why you did that.
Yeah, but see, I also love it for like the simple things. Like, if I wanted to push Floyd off a cliff, yes, I could use the action. It would absolutely let me push him. But the saving rolls, like, it's the little things that matter. Like, yeah, you can do it. But hold on, you're not the all-time god here. See what the god has to say. And if he goes flying, he deserves it. That's how I love this game.
Well, I can't wait to play a game and have the two of you basically get into a slap fight at the edge of a cliff.
I will force... What is... Oh, God. I wish I knew the name of that spell I love so much. I'll do that to you, Floyd. I'll do it.
Let's see. A quick entangle, and then just kick you both off the edge.
But see, I will use sacred ground right before I smack Floyd and watch it do nothing. I also realize, and things like sacred ground mean even you can't desecrate it or it's not sacred ground. I almost won a really hard fight. And I needed to heal, but I didn't have any more potions, so I was going to use Sacred Ground, let them expend a turn, then get an attack off and hope I killed them. But what I did was use Sacred Ground and then do a basic attack, which breaks Sacred Ground, and then I missed.
Yeah, you always got to read those full...
This game is forcing me to become a very, very prolific reader, an understander of skills. But yep. Once you got them down packed and you understand, oh my God, I've been having so much more fun than I did in the beginning. I think that's why I'm liking it more. It's getting better and better, and I'm also getting in my world. I feel like I'm at Super Saiyan 2 right now, but I don't know.
Yeah, but yes, I just walked into Act 2, so yeah. Someone's about to come smack your ass back down.
Oh, the minute I walked into Act 2, like I said, the thing that I shot off the cliff with the thunderous arrow, that was because of the way it positioned itself. Had I been on the other end of that, I would have been all four of us off the edge of the cliff. Goodbye. Have a nice day. It just happened in reverse because of the way I play. I play really spread out from my other characters because my thief is a true thief. He just hides in corners and things. He never gets an initiative roll because he's never there when the initiative happens. I always come in from the back end. I love it. I love it. This is a D&D experience I always wanted but never knew I was going to get.
Yeah.
And I can't wait to have
Bryan. It
sounds
like
it's
going better for you than getting lost in a blizzard.
Oh no. I have been smitten, smited by most things upon this map.
What? And I must say. Hey, y'all got lost in the blizzard on y'all. I didn't do that to you.
I mean, I was fine.
Listen,
and eventually I remembered that thing, like, hey, we should tie ourselves together. Yeah. After we lost half the party.
I assumed that was going to be the first thing y'all did, but nope.
I felt dumb because I was like, damn it, I know how D&D works. Everyone else had an excuse. I didn't. I also didn't feel that bad because I was like, y'all the ones that fucked your throws up.
Yeah, that's true.
But more or less.
Wasn't the first person who got lost like supposed to have the easiest chance of doing
it?
Yeah. Because that's fucking D&D, baby.
It is.
It's like, you know, that other campaign where I'm like, oh, I have great charisma. I'm going to walk in this shop and a critical failure. Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, you couldn't pass fucking charisma throws for your life.
No. And I was a charisma-based character.
No persuasion.
I was playing a sorcerer. And they were like focused skills. No, it was such shit. Good times.
Amazing.
Yeah, so I want a computer.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't wait to get you in there. Good times to be had for sure.
Were you working on yours, Bryan? Is that why it's out there?
It's out there because I'm going to.
Got it.
So once again, I'm going to try one last time. I'm getting a different type of thermal grease. Because I spent far too much time on Reddit and reading what everyone has to say about thermal grease, which are fun arguments back and forth. Because obviously everyone's a fan of whatever. But so I'm trying this new thermal grease, and I'm going to have enough that I'll be able to try it on this one. And if it doesn't work, doesn't fix it with that, there'll still be enough that then I can put the new computer together and use it on that.
I get that.
But just for ease, and also because the whole thing, because the other computer, it's the Threadripper, because if you remember, we were putting that computer together to edit video.
Correct, yeah.
Which is why we got the Threadripper, which is what it's good at. It's not necessarily the best for gaming. It's good at doing multiple tasks at a time, not focusing on a singular task necessarily. So, if I can fix this one, which has the Intel chipset in it, I would much rather do that. Because I'm just using it for gaming. We haven't been doing any videos. True. So. Yeah, so, hooray! So, I think Friday it's supposed to come in, but, I mean, because we're in Chicago, everything comes early. I wouldn't be surprised if it's here tomorrow, honestly. Like, it just wouldn't surprise me.
Nice.
So, while y'all have been having a super fun time playing one game for a long, long time... I've played a shit ton of different games.
Okay. What have you been playing?
So, I played Fallout 76 for one more day.
Nice.
And then, you know, the RNG god of, oh yeah, this is an MMO and you want me to pay for shit, reared its head where there was just no way to get screws. And you need that for everything. And once you hit, like, level 45, your equipment degrades so fucking quickly in fights that you're constantly having to repair it. And I don't have the screws to do it. And I was like, I'm not doing this. This is now Screw Finder of the game. And
I need screws, damn it.
And I was like, cool, I'm glad I didn't pay for that. That was fun for a little bit, and I'm done now. I finished Persona 4 Golden.
Nice.
And I got the true ending. Huge pain in the ass. But I got to, you know, do two extra dungeons for that. That shit just kept dragging on. I was like, I was so ready to be done with that game. 89 hours.
Damn.
Yeah. I will say one of the two special dungeons actually had, like, some pretty cool mechanics to it. So that was fun. And then the final dungeon was just like, oh, we're out of ideas. Here's another regular dungeon. And I'm like, but you just had this cool one where you like changed a bunch of stuff and it was like fresh and fun. And that's over. And now this one. Okay, fuck it. Whatever. And can I make like my biggest complaint with JRPGs? The final bosses are always just fucking wars of attrition for no fucking reason. Mm-hmm. They're like hour-long fights where it's like, cool, I have the four characters. Every single one of them is doing the same action every fucking turn. You know, it's damage, 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 heal. Damage, 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 heal. And I'm just doing the same thing for an hour. And it's just like, just to have a sponge of health. And like, it's not, they're never interesting fights. They're just like, and because it's turn-based, it's not like, yeah, and it's just, I hate it.
I hate that.
I'm like, oh, it's just such a cop-out. You know? It's like the opposite problem, like, with FromSoft, where usually by the time you get to the end of the FromSoft game, you're so powerful, the last boss, you're like, really, that was the last boss?
Yeah. Then that's because, in FromSoft games, you tend to go, I'm finna do this, and get so overpowered because you're just doing the side stuff because you got sidetracked so quickly.
Isn't that what makes it fun?
Yeah.
It's not like you can get super sidetracked until you get to, like, the Elden Ring area of games, you know? Yeah. Like in 3, yeah, there's like different areas you can go to get like extra weapons, and there, you know, there's the optional bosses always, but it's not like even those really. I mean, what's that account to for the whole game in 3? Maybe 15 extra levels, maybe. Yeah, I don't know. And then I started playing Wasteland 2 again,
but I've seen.
Yeah, so what's really cool is I was like, it's been sitting on the Xbox, and I'm like, oh, I don't want to start again. Because I had it on Steam, because I actually did the Kickstarter for that game. So I had it on Steam, I played for a while, and then for whatever reason, I know why. Because I only had my laptop at that point. And it didn't run well on the laptop, so it just kind of got lost to the memories of time. And then I was playing on PC because it was on Game Pass. And so that's what was nice about that is now I'm playing on the Xbox. That save was still in the cloud.
Right.
So I didn't lose anything. And you'll get a kick out of this. You want to know how old that save is from that PC? Is one of the characters in my party is named Papi Chulo Jr.
Nice.
Yeah, you're my surgeon and computer scientist guy.
That's actually wild.
Yeah. But no, that's great. It's fun that it's in exile because it's got that, you know, a little bit of that humor, like from Fallout 2 kind of stuff. Also, that game is insanely stupidly hard at times. I've had to turn it down to the lowest difficulty setting because I literally just could not get past a fight. And I can't put this, and then what, and they do so much damage, and the fucking fuck you, and I'm dead now.
Right.
And I fucked up so many missions because I went to an area early. And eventually had to run away from that area. But one of the things I really like about Wasteland is, like, you leave that area and you go to do something else. But, like, there's kind of, like, this behind-the-scenes, like, timer in the game. Like, it's not a true timer. Like, you can spend as much time as you want in this area. But, like, if you don't finish things and leave that area, there's consequences. So I've basically failed to save a couple towns because I got there too early and I was like, oh, I gotta go back and do some of this other shit that's lower level so I can actually get, and then when I came back and it's like, oh, cool, and these people are all dead now.
That's fucked up.
Yeah, but it's awesome though. I love it because I'm like, there's consequences. Like, you have to fucking do shit. Like, one of the first missions in the game is you basically have to choose one of these two towns that are both calling for help to go to.
Mm-hmm.
This is kind of how the game teaches you that there's going to be, like, lasting consequences based on your decisions. And whichever one you go to, you only have time to save one, basically, is what it comes down to. So you're going to lose one of them no matter what. And you just have to pick which one. And I love it because I'm like, there needs to be, like, you know, like basically what I'm excited about with Baldur's Gate and hearing you guys talk about it is the same thing. It was like, there's consequences to the shit you decide to do.
Right.
And actual consequences, like parts of the game might just be done and shut off. And yeah, like I'm playing Wasteland and I fucked up so much stuff. I'm like, oh, cool. I kind of want to play this again when I finish it because I'd like to not fuck some of that stuff up and see what happens.
I'd like to get it right this time.
Well, one of the things I really fucked up is, so there's three basically like speech skills trees that you can use.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a smart ass, kiss ass, and hard ass. And the problem is, one of the backgrounds I took for a character, because when I was building him, I'm like, oh, that's awesome. And I didn't read it all correctly.
Ah.
Is that you get a free point in the hard ass skill, and then it acts like it's a level 10. So you will always, no matter what, like 10 is the highest you can get a skill.
Uh-huh.
So you'll always act like you're level 10. Yeah, so the problem is that you can only ever use hard ass responses. You can't do the kiss ass from smart ass.
Got it.
And early in the game, you usually have the option to do all three. As you get later in the game, certain characters will only respond to certain things.
Mm-hmm.
So there's just a bunch of like speech checks I just can't do. Because it's like, oh, I need to be a smart ass to get past this speech check. And I can't. Even if I put the points in it,
mm-hmm.
you can't use the skill. You're just cut off from the skill for the rest of the game.
Damn.
So there was one where I could have talked my way out of something, but I couldn't. And so then I had to kill everyone.
Because I'm a hard ass.
Yep.
You know what?
It's just like, fuck you, you're done.
This sounds like my barbarian playthrough right now.
Yeah, that sounds like a barbarian, yeah.
Yeah, at least they give me options sometimes, though. It's like, hey, you can be insightful. You can be persuasive. Or, parentheses, barbarian. Oh, I don't even look at what he said. I choose that option.
Oh, yeah.
And more than likely, it's...
If they give me, like, a job, like a class option dialogue, I'm choosing it every time. Power.
Oh, absolutely.
Now, I notice
that's,
as an
that's
elf...
That's the role-playing part of the damn game.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed as I've played, you know, with three different characters now, I think tieflings are treated so terribly. Like, I understand they're like little devils, but still, it's just everybody I talk to is just like disgust. What did I do to you?
You should see how they react when they see a dragonborn. Every time. Oh my god, shut the fuck up, bitch. I'm here to help.
I am not your enemy.
Except when I became an Oathbreaker Paladin. Because then, then that goblin village... Okay, so this is how it happened. I was in a goblin village, and I had, like... I got attacked, but for the most part, the village itself was fine. So I'm walking through the village, and I was like, oh, shit, I should go, like, rest up from this fight. So I go to my camp. The Oathbreaker Paladin was there, and I was like, I'm finna go fight him. And then I saw his level, and I was like, I'm not finna fight that level 12. Nope.
She's gonna stomp you. Level 12 is Jesus, right?
Yep.
That's max. That's game max level.
Yeah. Max had so much health, and I was like, you know what? I'm gonna be nice to this guy. So we go through that whole dialogue thing where he tells me I'm an Oathbreaker, and I was like, all right, cool. I leave camp and decide to go full Anakin after he found out his mom died. I killed everybody in that bitch. All y'all gotta die.
Everybody's going to sleep now.
So basically you were like, okay, I'm an Oathbreaker. I'm not going to deal with getting back in the good graces of my god.
Nah.
I'm a Sith now. Fuck it. Time to die.
Pretty much. It just is what it is. That's why I at least try to find out what people want first. And I see if they're worth dying for.
Nah.
Yeah, I did do that in Wasteland 2, where someone was asking for money to enter a town,
mm-hmm.
and I knew it was taken over by this gang, and I was supposed to go there, and I was like, fuck you, And I didn't pay, and we got in a fight, and then I walked in the town, and I'm going through the town, killing all these people, and I realize, oh, there's, like, special sections in this town, and there's a bunch of NPCs here, and I'm like, oh, this is, like, one of them quest towns. Yeah. So I was like, I'm gonna go reload that.
Because I have just murdered everyone.
I'm like, I just, yeah, I'm like, I can't keep being underpowered. Mm-hmm. And I'm probably still going to have to kill all the people in the town at some point, but I'm also, like, literally I'm in that town now, like, gathering a bunch of side quests.
While you were playing, has anybody pissed you off to the point where you do that Fallout thing where it's like, you know what? I'm finna say this. Let me come right
save
back.
Save it and kill them? Oh, absolutely. Oh, absolutely.
Come here, bitch.
There's this one where it's literally, like, running from one end of the town and back and back and forth, and like you actually have to switch maps. Mm-hmm. And of course, everyone, the people you're running to, are on the absolute furthest sides away, and they're both annoying as shit. And they're arguing over fucking, well, I mean, they're arguing over something, but it's also like they're being so stupid. And finally, I just got sick of it, and I was like, I'm gonna put a bullet in this motherfucker. I did it.
I was like, I'm
and
done.
I had to like kill like eight other people, and then I was like, okay, that's out of my system. Reload.
Yeah. Sometimes you just gotta get that aggression out.
You got to sometimes. Yeah. Like, I'm sure that'll happen to me in Baldur's Gate. I'm sure I'll have those moments like you have, Eddie, where I'm like, okay, I'm in a good spot. Also, these people have been pissing me off. So, before I'm done for the night, I'm gonna leave all this evil in the game. Save. Y'all dead.
Dead to rights.
Yeah.
Good times.
I also... Because on top of, like, I've been playing too many games, and I'm not even mentioning, there's also games that I've played that aren't on the list of stuff I wanted to talk about. Mm. I am so fucking sick of playing games. I actually watched two movies today.
Oh, wow.
I know. Well, one and a half. Expendables 3 really isn't that as good as, I mean, they're not, like, great movies to begin right. with, but 3 is more annoying. But that's a different podcast. So I was playing some Street Fighter VI. I'm doing the World Tour mode again. I had to actually look up one of the quests I was trying to do on that shit.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's like, oh, here's another quest. And I'm like, that shit is so fucking long. And like, props, it's great. But I'm also at that point where I'm like, I'm kind of sick of doing this shit, but I'm so invested that I want to finish this. But I don't want to do this anymore.
Like, I can't take this.
Yeah. And then I played some Broforce because Broforce Forever Update is out.
Yeah.
And it's on Game Pass.
Love free.
We love that.
Well, free asterisk.
Yeah, yeah. Quotations.
But while I'm on the subject of Street Fighter 6, did you hear about there's a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle and Street Fighter 6 crossover?
No, I didn't know that.
Oh. So it's costumes, and there's like some emotes, I think, too, and stuff like that, so you can dress up for just under $15.
Hmm. Not doing that.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, like, I could kind of see maybe $5 because obviously coders and artists and everybody and even QA testers make sure no clipping and works with moves. And I can understand that. Except also that money's not going to them.
Right.
And also when I say $15, that's per turtle.
Huh? Nah.
Yeah.
And I fuck that. Yeah. I thought you meant as a pack.
Nope.
That's and remember,
these are just costumes.
Mm-hmm.
They're not like new fighters.
Fucking
they're skins. Costumes you can put on. Yeah, you're whatever. And the reason why I say it's about $15 also is because you have to buy Street Fighter coins because, you know, that's the new way that they fuck you over. And so say you wanted to just buy one. The cheapest way to do that is... For $12, you can get 610 coins. and then buy 250 coins for $5. Why is there a pack of 610 coins?
What are you going to do with all of that?
So that way you have a leftover that you'll never be able to use. Mm-hmm. It's so fucking dumb. But yeah, I guess like if you buy the bigger packs, you know, where you save money, you get enough for all four of them for like $55. Which, by the way, are costumes.
Costumes.
That you can't, yeah, no. Like, the extra character they've released is less than that. The game was $60.
It was, yeah. I'm not. No.
And that came with a bunch of costumes. Yeah. Oh, there's possibly, maybe, don't know, going to be Lego Animal Crossing sets.
Hmm.
Huh. And the reason we don't know is because, like, leakers, like Lego leakers.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
It sounds like the worst bladder problem ever.
Lego leakers. Horrible sports team.
So, yeah, right? Oh, could you imagine having to piss Legos?
Oh.
Yeah. Fuck stepping on them. Fuck, what are they? Gallstones or whatever the fuck they are.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Legos. Kidney stones.
That's the ticket.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
A gallbladder was in my head for some reason. So March 2024 is possibly, maybe, because remember, this is all not confirmed.
Right.
But they have the ID numbers for the five things, and they have the prices. Ah. That's what the leak was. So if it hasn't been canceled, and I mean, co-abs with Lego have been canceled when they've had all the information out, so we'll see. Sets are priced between $15 and $75. Or, if you're a boomer and still think that this makes things sound cheaper, $14.99 and $74.99.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah.
Got me excited talking like that.
Oh my god, it's so much less, right?
Yeah.
I fucking hate that dumbass shit.
You better get used to it.
Yeah, no shit, it's not going anywhere, but it's the dumbest fucking thing ever, and nobody falls for it. It's such a fucking boomer-ass thing. Ugh.
You said that like you could see a boomer in front of you.
Fuck you, boomer.
Boomer.
Fucking $15. It's just $15. So I can say that and then you don't need the point. You save, like, it's smaller, it's snappy, whatever. Oh, hey, this is a quick, fun one. Overwatch 2 is on Steam now.
No one cares.
Yeah, it's got a mostly negative rating.
No, Go check that again. It's overwhelmingly negative.
I didn't want to. Listen, I was fine with the 6,000 negatives.
First off, I remember when that game first dropped. I was so excited. Oh, so much fun. Then I woke up.
It was fucking
Overwatch.
I saw like the trailer, like the gameplay trailer of that game before it came out. I was like, that's just one. What are y'all doing?
Exactly.
And that's why I didn't touch it.
You know what? I'm surprised nobody brought up the surprisingly petty news.
Which is?
That came with Baldur's Gate.
Which is?
How it is that we're paying it now and not on its original date at the, you know, was supposed to be at the end of August. Well, it is August now.
Oh, because they
supposed to be at the end of,
because they finished it early and they was like, here you go.
Yeah, they finished it early and say, here you go.
Exactly what they did.
Yeah, you know, word and the bird was there was a little petty ass company out there. They're not little, but they are petty. They were going to release their beautiful to game title Starfield on the same exact date. And, you know, from what I heard, those magnificent people over at could you give me the name of it?
Bethesda?
No, not Bethesda. The one that made Baldur's Gate.
Oh, shit. I forget.
Larian?
There we go. I was going to say Lotremaine. I don't know what the fuck I'm thinking about. But anyways.
I don't even know what Lotremaine is.
Exactly.
Sounds like a sports cream.
I think it was a medicine I used to give to the kids I worked with. Anyways, basically, their game was finished, as you said, Floyd.
Yeah.
And when they heard that, they was like, why would we get into a dick swinging competition, which you got? We'll release it earlier. 800,000 fucking people in the first fucking weekend.
Mm-hmm.
And the tweet Larian put out was 100K on release day will be a dream for us. And like 3 hours later, it was already at 500K. Like they smoked it. Starfield, I hope, because I'm going to play it. I'm hoping lives up to it, because I didn't expect Baldur's Gate. That was like the best gift I never saw coming. But I'm looking forward to Starfield.
Watching Baldur's Gate for a couple of years now.
Same.
I'd be lost in the sauce.
See, here's my thing, right? Like, I get that there's going to be this whole, like, Baldur's Gate 3 versus Starfield. I'm not in that camp at all. Well, I'm just not in that camp. They're two different games.
Exactly.
I'm going at both of them with two different expectations and looking for two different experiences.
Yeah, like,
they are so different types of RPGs that I'm not comparing them to each other. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm going to get something different out of Starfield than what I'm trying to get out of Baldur's Gate. And I was going to play both of them, and I'm probably going to enjoy both of them. And I'm not, like, I'm just looking for such different things. It'd be like saying, like, Starfield's coming out, and let me compare it to Minecraft. Mm-hmm. Like, why? I mean, I'm getting different experiences out of those. I'm not looking for the same thing in the games. And, like, I know there's going to be all the comparisons, and there's going to be, like, and this is why this, and you know, it's just going to be a Sony versus Microsoft bullshit. I'm like, look, if you want to pick one, but it's easier to get both of these than it is to get two fucking consoles.
Yeah. Baldur's Gate is causing the Elden Ring effect with the big studios again, where they came out and it's like, don't expect us to keep, you know, we can't live up to that. Yeah. It's like, you better, bitch. Give us
some finished games?
Yeah.
They can live up to that if they put the work in and care about the product they're putting out.
They can't.
No, I know. Which, go for it.
No. Go ahead. I had a brain.
Well, I was just going to say, there's no way they can do it now because they keep laying people off, mm-hmm. and like shortening development times. And, oh yeah, not paying people, busting unions, sexually harassing employees, allegedly. But making sure that they take home their million upon million dollar bonuses. Yeah, no, you can't make games well when you're doing that. Like, just like fucking the problem with the restaurant industry for so long, when all you do is cut labor and put out shit product, no, you can't run a successful fucking restaurant. Oh, I'm going to leave it there because I'm about to get real angry about the state of a lot of shit.
Yeah.
When you put profit over product, the product's not going to be good.
Yeah, or you add in the fucking unnecessary ass like microtransactions. Annoying.
Yeah,
I'm so glad you mentioned that because I have it in my notes and I forgot to do it. Eddie, tell us about Diablo 4.
Yeah.
I haven't had you here for like 2 weeks, bro.
I forgot I owned that. I can't believe. You know what? It's a shame. I was never going to get the game. I was going to always wait until it became free.
Mm-hmm.
And one of my good friends literally had to buy it for me to get me to play it. And after playing it, and, you know, I think it's no secret, I consume content crazy fast. So if I'm playing your game, I think I'm the type of person you want to play your game. I'm going to fucking play it. I'm going to try to figure out everything you can fucking figure out in the first 30 fucking minutes because I just like to do that. I figured out everything I need to know about that game in the first 5 minutes. Hey, here's how we're going to do it. We have seasons now. Oh, you have seasons. Yeah, we have season passes. Okay, you know, most games have season passes, no big deal. Hey, within the season passes, we have a season system. What's in your season system? Every season, you have to create a new character and get them to max level to get all the rewards and stuff. Okay, cool, no problem. You know, I can keep that character afterwards, right? Yeah. But if you want to play with anybody, anywhere, at any time, who's currently playing a different season other than the one you're playing, absolutely not. You must play a new character and play the game completely over. But guess what? If you want to pay a little bit of money, we can get you past that. We can help you out with that. Mm-hmm. And one thing about me, I don't give a fuck if the title of the game was microtransaction hell. I'm never going to give you any money. I'm just not. I'm going to try to overcome it. I'm just not. I'm not going to do it.
Wait. Now I just want to learn how to make video games so I can make a video game called Microtransaction Hell.
Like, it was a great title.
You know it would sell so well. Just make it like an idle clicker, man. Right. You don't need any skill to make those.
Exactly. And within that, I go and I level up all four base characters to level 40, which max level before you get into like the paragons and other shit is 50, and then it goes up to 70, then you get your paragons and all that shit within it. So I went up to 40 with each one of these characters, and I must say, I must say, the game's terrible. It is the same game I have always played. And for somebody who like me, who I'm so happy games have settings where they go, hey, what type of player are you? You're a beginner, you play this shit, or you just want to get raped? I always will pick no loop. Like, that's just my style. I would play on hardcore if I didn't know I was a dumbass who would die all the time.
You don't want to play Diablo 4 on hardcore anyway. Not at least for 5 years till the servers are actually fixed.
Oh, yeah. And I come to find out about this game, it's that in the recent patch right before I bought it, they purposely lowered the damage of all the characters.
Mm-hmm.
And then in a Q&A session of some kind, they said, we don't know why we lowered the damage of all the characters.
Yeah, but they didn't undo it though, right?
No, they didn't.
No, I mean, why not? So you do know why you did it. Because that way you can fucking sell people shit.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Because when the game becomes such a grind that you can't get to the next milestone without shelling over cash, you are now playing a pay-to-win game.
Now, I will say, that level between pay-to-win and play-to-win, with Diablo, it's not as bad as some other ones. But the fact that you have set it up to where it's almost like, hey, if you play this game, this is the only... They put it in one of those situations where... You can only play this game. Like, I know if they're playing Diablo right now, they want anything out of it, they're going to have to play this entire season, or they're going to have to max that character out, because the way they set it up, they almost assured I will not see you the next season. Because just like me, once these characters become useless and I can't play with anybody, fuck that. Fuck you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck you guys.
Also, I'm just waiting. Like, give it some time. I guarantee you, like, if you don't have the battle pass, all of a sudden, like, oh, well, if you have the battle pass, you can unlock these three special world bosses. Free players don't get that. Like, it's starting with cosmetic shit. You know it's going further than that.
No. It's just... It's a big bowl of meh, if you ask me, but... Diablo is not my preferred piece of cake anymore. You know, it's just not. I'm more interested in the other piece of bullshit that should be coming out soon enough. Just waiting on the announcement.
What?
We were talking about microtransactions and things, and, you know, releasing full games and not monetizing off bullshit. When all of that sounds good until one game is going to come out and do all the shit we said wrong. And they're going to make the most money by doing it the worst way possible. And I'm going to be one of the people who contributes to their pockets. And that's going to be Grand Theft Auto.
Oh.
I was going to say, they already did that.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. It's just
what,
like,
are you talking about? Like, it's already been done.
It's like,
they're,
yeah,
we're just going to do it again.
But that's why things like it. I like the two sides of the coin, though. It's fucked up, but I do. Because, yes, I'm enjoying Baldur's Gate because I don't know the last time I played a fully released game on launch. But at the same time...
Amazing concept, right?
Bruh, I just... rest in peace, Anthem, right? Anyways.
Oh, wow. Pick them while they're down, eh?
Anyways.
Well, actually, I think technically you pissed on Anthem's grave because it's dead now.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, like I said, if they... You know what? We'll put anthems flying in microtransaction hell. And that just be part of it. That's what you do. You pay to fly a little bit faster.
That game has so much potential.
Oh, yeah, it did. At point A, and then when you went from point B to capture the supplies, and then from point C to wipe out the five guys, and then to point D to capture the guys, and then point C to kill the five people, and then to defend the point on capture A,
and then
start cutscene movie and fly. Yeah. Which most games do the same fucking thing, but goddamn, they do it better than that. You could throw a little story in there. I mean, look at Destiny. It's the same thing with different character models, but at least there's a nice story sprinkled into it. Anthem was kind of like one long trip around a space station you didn't want to be on anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's almost like when EA takes a studio and forces them to make a game that they've never made. It gets fucked up somehow, which then gives them an excuse to close down the studio and fire everyone. They've totally not done that like 10 or 12 times already.
Hey, but that's what friends are for, right?
Yeah.
Screw them.
Yeah.
Well, luckily, we got
I mean, I wasn't going to play Diablo 4 anyway, but now I definitely won't bother.
Nah. They might change
Even think I'm going to bother if it's free. Like, I was already that far. Everything I read about it, I'm just like, I don't fucking care. I'm done.
Yeah.
The thing about it, too, is I'm like, you're a hack and slash loot grinder. There's other games out there.
Yeah, but like, it's kind of hard,
I don't need
man.
It.
It's hard to tell yourself certain things, cause, you know. The same day Starfield comes out, NBA 2K24 comes out. I complain about this game every year. I'm gonna buy it. And I'm gonna play it. Play the shit out of it. Now, if there ever was a game that could truly be named microtransaction hell, it would be NBA 2K24. If there was ever a game, it would just be that.
The VC grind. Oh my shit.
And it's like, I know for the people who know me that may hear it, I'm talking shit because I'm a grinder. It don't matter, RPG, any game. Floyd, you know, a week from now, I'll be there. It makes no difference to me. I don't fuck your money. I exist just to prove that the microtransactions aren't real. But it's because of people like me that games get over shit like that. Because they're like, see, there's a guy's willing to do it. No, I'm just proving a fucking point. But 2K is one of those games that basically says, hey, either you're going to play me every day when you got a free fucking minute, and in a month you'll be ready to actually go play the game, or give me $200 right now and make you a fucking all-star.
Yeah.
That's the true meaning of that game. Wait, but guess what? You still got to grind for badge specific shit. But money-wise, we'll start you off as a 60 overall. You give me $200 max. I make you a 95 right now.
So it's basically like, oh, that's cool, kid. You know, you're doing good. I got these steroids here, though.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Now, hold on. To be honest with you, you will start the game off at 60, a 65 overall. That's just how they always do you. And max money on release days, this is always the same. It used to be $50 could get you from 65 to 88, which will be the cap before you start had to basically grinding and getting your level up so you can actually get higher overalls.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's $200 flat to go from 65 to literally 88 again. So it's kind of damned if you do, damned if you don't. I like the concept back when it was $50 because it was like, okay, if you don't have time to grind out this money, the least we can do is we'll make it so you're viable out there. And it'll cost you $50 if you want to cheat the game real quick. Now they're telling people, shit, if you want to cheat the game, we'll charge you $200. But we going to make it so fucking hard for you to get a level up anyways, you damn near consider just spending $50 just to make yourself a little bit better. Because now $50 will get you from 65 to 69. It's the craziest. Like, this shit is so convoluted now. It's just ridiculous. And, you know?
You know, it'd be better than that.
What's that?
If, they didn't make the grind so bad so that it was actually doable and you could just play the game that you've already paid for.
Yeah, but why, how would you give them more money if they did that?
Well, I know, and see, that's their fucking
room. Yeah.
Oh, wait. Remember, we're only talking about the money to upgrade your character.
We're not talking about the ultimate team.
We ain't talking about the Mall of America that they have inside of the online system where mm-hmm. all the clothes cost, if you put dollar to in-game currency value, it's literally $1.50 per in-game clothing item, but you can only buy it at $10 a pop. Mm-hmm. Certain items in the game are worth $10 of real life money in just one, like a t-shirt or something.
Right, yeah.
Oh, they're not actually worth that.
No, they're not worth anything. It's just free money. And that's the second part. It's actually a triangle. Because then we have the trading card mode called My Team, where you buy these virtual packs of basketball cards and you try to pick the good ones out that they release a new good one. Because everybody needs a pink Zion. We all need an amethyst fucking Kawhi Leonard. Oh, don't forget about the Opal Michael Jordan pack releasing later on this year like it did the last 14 fucking years. But, you know, it just... you gotta get it. It's like fucking Pokemon, man.
Man, can you imagine? Fucking... The Pokemon guys better not, like, get wise to this shit.
They did with Pokemon Go. Shit, Niantic was charging out the ass if you couldn't make it to them. Let you live out. I lived in a rural area.
Yeah, but that's a mobile game. That's not a real game, and I don't care.
Hey. You said mobile game. That makes it a game. Let the record show it.
Now, if I got to put the word mobile in front of it.
Hey, listen, I wish I could have put my name behind PUBG Mobile. The game made so much fucking money off being... I don't see how people are fucking ridiculous for shit like that.
You know, I mean, I just look at some of this dumb shit that people spend money on, you know, after they've already bought a game. And I'm like, you could just give me that money. I'll draw you a picture.
Well...
It won't be very good, but it'll be worth the same of the fucking stupid-ass shit that you bought in a game that, by the way, there will be a new one next year. So all the shit you just bought in this game doesn't go to the new game.
Yeah.
Just give me the money. I'll do better things with it, like buy food.
Like, I'm in the same boat. I bought Grand Theft Auto on the PC just so I could download 5M and play the RP servers.
Oh, the funny thing about that. Take-Two just bought them.
Yeah, I was just going to say, didn't they get bought? Yeah, they got bought out.
Mm-hmm. 5M and the one for Red Dead as well.
Mm-hmm.
Why not buy the ultimate sandbox creator for your game?
So here's the thing about that, right? Because remember, Rockstar is owned by Take-Two.
Mm-hmm.
Take-Two also does 2K Sports.
Yes, they do.
Yeah, those servers aren't going to be free no more.
Oh, no.
Like, the best thing here is that now you're going to have to pay a monthly fee to be on those fucking things. Remember, they've also spent years trying to get that shit shut down.
Yeah.
They bought it now. They might just shut it down.
But you know what's funny?
Companies
about that?
Don't fucking care about you. They care about your money.
That's true. But as a member of the WoW community, you shut one down, 7,000 pop back up.
Oh, Hydra.
Yeah, but see, here's the thing, though. They didn't win their court battles the first time because they didn't have the IP. Now that they own the people who originally created this, they technically own the intelligent rights, whatever the fuck they're called, to that. And if they monetize it and then someone tries to make a new one, then they can probably get away with suing and getting it shut down.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, like, I read the article on this, and the person writing the article is a fucking idiot, because they're like, oh, this is fantastic now. And I'm like, you're a fucking bootlicking piece of shit. No, it's not. Anytime something independent is bought by a large company, it is never good.
Yeah, no, I can't think of anything.
Because there's not one.
Hmm.
Big companies getting bigger do not make them more efficient or like have them put out better products. It actually causes the opposite to happen.
Hmm.
And this has been our podcast Amazon. On anti-capitalism today. Yeah, Amazon's terrible. What are you talking about? Amazon is the biggest example of exactly what I'm talking about.
You know? As somebody who doesn't use it, I guess I can agree with you. But every once in a while, every blue moon, I order something off Amazon. And I'm proud of myself.
Yeah, so do I, because you can't get it anywhere else.
Exactly.
Which is the fucking problem.
Which is why they should start
They set the
weed.
Prices, because they have no competition. And in fact, their competition has to use their site just to be able to compete against them on their own site. It is the most anti-competition shit ever. I'm not getting into this. We've already
have
been
you not got out? Have you not been playing Monopoly Go lately?
No.
With the rest of the world?
Ew. No.
Absolutely not.
Also, Borderlands 3 sucks.
Yes. Correct.
Okay. But while we're on the subject of things that suck, let's talk about something that doesn't.
Jeff Bezos. Oh, something that doesn't. Okay.
Let's remember that Oktoberfest is this September, folks.
It is.
Meh.
I'm excited.
I'll Oktoberfest at home.
I'm going to get my schnitzel.
Leaner schnitzel.
Oh, God. Somebody's going to hate me.
Why?
Because the way schnitzel is going to be flying out of my mouth.
Of course.
Keep your schnitzel in your mouth. Or your pants. I don't care which.
Going to have a schnitz and a good time.
Ah, schnitzel.
Ah, shit.
Come back around to me. I'll have a better one.
Yeah. I have none, so, you know.
Yeah, I got nothing. Eddie, you got any other complaints or good news for us?
Let's see. New business. Nope, I'm all good.
All right, well, then I officially call this episode 28 to a close.
Dang.
It's episode 28, right?
I'm assuming.
Shit. I hope so. It is now, motherfuckers. Right. All right. Thanks for putting up with us. We love y'all.
Bye-bye.
Bro-bye.
Peace and hair grease.